Since 2003, when Prince William first announced that he was dating Kate Middleton, all eyes were on the now Duchess of Cambridge. At one point, poor Kate must have felt as if she could do no right. Almost everywhere you looked, there was a magazine or other publication that was scrutinizing her for anything she did. Once Kate and William got married, a lot of people thought that the media's attention would suddenly die down. However, just the opposite happened. The media seems to be more intrusive than ever now that she is married to the prince and has three children of her own. When Prince Harry announced that he was dating an American actress in 2016, Kate might have let out a brief sigh of relief, hoping that the media would pay more attention to Meghan Markle than her. And while the media does seem to be obsessed with learning every aspect of Markle's life, they still have, and will continue to have, a vested interest in Kate. The media obviously seems to be enamored with both of the duchesses. But is one of them getting treated differently than the other by the media? Here is what we know about how Markle and Middleton are viewed by the public eye. The media views Meghan Markle as a unique woman. When Kate got engaged to William, it was big news at the time due to the fact that Kate was considered a commoner. While it is not unheard of for royals to marry commoners, William was one of the first royals in the direct line of the throne to marry someone who was not a member of the aristocracy or nobility. Being that Kate was the only commoner in this century to marry so close to the throne, people were understandably curious about how Kate would be able to adjust to royal life. When Harry married Meghan, people were more than just a little curious about the American actress, they were downright blown away. Harry wasn't just marrying a commoner, he was marrying an American, someone who knew very little about how a monarchy even worked. People all over the world became obsessed with learning more about how a divorced American woman was able to snag her very own, real-life Prince Charming. The media was also eager to weigh in on the unique situation as well. Although she is neither the first American woman to marry into a royal family nor even the first American actress to become a royal, award-winning actress, Grace Kelly, married the Prince of Monaco in 1956, the media had portrayed her as somewhat of a revolutionary person. Instead of being praised for that, however, they seemed to instead try to dig around until they could find out any and all faults that she may have, and even spreading rumors about her relationships with the other members of the royal family. Meghan Markle's family only adds fuel to the fire. While it does seem like the media seems to care more about digging up on dirt on Meghan than it does Kate, there may be a good reason for that. Meghan is an easier target. When it comes to trying to finding out anything negative about the Duchess of Sussex, the media does not have to work too hard. Meghan's father and half-sister are always more than happy to give them what they want. They use every opportunity that they can to make Meghan look as if she does not care about her family back home. Last Christmas, Meghan's half-sister, Samantha Markle, sent a Christmas card to Meghan that begged her to see her father for Christmas. She had insinuated in the card that their father probably was not going to be alive much longer and he would really like to spend his last few Christmases with Meghan. How do we know what the card said? Well, she didn't actually send it to Meghan. Instead, she sent a copy of it to The Mirror, who was more than happy to publish it. Her sister had also pointed out on Twitter that Meghan did not see her father on his birthday. Although, Meghan's absence at her father's birthday party should have come at no surprise to her family. Especially when you consider the fact that her own father has sold numerous defaming stories about Meghan and has even published a 5-page letter that Meghan wrote to him, asking him to please stop going to the media. Why does the media treat Meghan Markle differently than Kate Middleton? Sometimes the media paints Meghan in a good light and sometimes they showcase the negative aspects of her life. They have done the same things to Kate as well, however, the media does seem to be more in a frenzy when it comes to Markle. The fact that she is an American woman living as a royal and the fact that her family throws her under the bus at every opportunity, means that, unfortunately, the media does have more to scrutinize when it comes to Markle's life. However, no matter how differently the media decides to treat Meghan, you can be sure that her Prince Charming, Harry, will stand by her side and protect her as much as he can. Not that she needs his protection, Meghan's proven to be strong and resilient. It's not long until Prince Harry and Meghan Markle's baby arrives with speculation rife as to how many traditions they will adhere to with their birth plan. There's been mention of a holistic birth and a more natural method as well as rumors Meghan will snub the Lindo wing where the Duchess of Cambridge gave birth to her three children. Amongst all the rumors, one thing seems pretty certain: Prince Harry won't be pacing the corridor outside. In the new ITV documentary, Secrets of the Royal Babies, Harry and Meghan, royal historian Kate Williams says Prince Harry is so likely to attend the birth. He'll be there doing yoga moves with Meghan, she jokes. What normally happens is that there is an encrypted phone that cannot be tapped and he will tell her, whether it's a girl or boy, explains Williams. Queen Elizabeth II has to know before Prince Charles or Meghan's mother because she's the head of the family. Prince William also followed the same rule when his children were both. After Prince George was born, he called the Queen on an encrypted phone line to let her know George had arrived, then rang Kate's family. The rule is just one of the traditions that the couple has to adhere to thanks to royal protocol. After the phone call is made, the Duke and Duchess get a few moments with the little one before an official statement is issued by the palace, then the selection of godparents, then the christening. But when will we know the name? Historically, it could take quite a while. Prince Charles was nameless for about a month, but in the case of George and Charlotte, their names were announced just 2 days after they were born, whereas Prince Louis' name was shared 4 days later. Hopefully we won't have to wait too long. At least their new home at Frogmore Cottage is nearly ready and they are already looking at childcare and birth plans. Meghan Markle's mother Doria Ragland will be flying over from LA to be by her daughter's side as the Duchess prepares for her first child this month. As reported today, sources have said Doria will not be able to stay with Meghan for long as she has to go home and look after her dogs, according to the Sunday Mirror. A source said yesterday, Doria should be here for the birth and will be staying. But then she has to get back to her dogs and work. Meghan is also allegedly decorating their new home in Frogmore Cottage with posters from her old home in Canada. The £3 million cottage on the Windsor's Frogmore estate will be decorated with the posters from Toronto, Canada, where she played paralegal Rachel Zane in the US legal drama, Suits. Meghan has reportedly already decorated the cottage with expensive artwork and family pictures. She has also swapped interior design tips with friend and ex-Spice Girl Victoria Beckham. A palace insider said, Harry and Meghan want to make Frogmore as homely as possible and Meghan has brought over a lot of posters. Frogmore used to house royal staff, but since then the cottage has been renovated to make a family home. It comes as the couple's new Instagram account posted a graffiti mural of former South African President Nelson Mandela alongside a quote from his autobiography. The Sussex Royal Instagram account post was made as a plea to ask those wishing to send gifts to the couple for their firstborn to instead donate to charity. The photo's caption read, "The Duke and Duchess of Sussex are so grateful for the well wishes in anticipation of their firstborn. Today we introduce you to one of four charities the couple has asked that you consider supporting in lieu of sending gifts. Please meet the Lunchbox Fund provides a nutritious daily school meal to children in South Africa who would otherwise go hungry. Since its inception, the Lunchbox Fund has provided over 20 million meals to school children in need. The account also broke the record for hitting 1 million followers faster than any other account." It has been reported today that Duchess Meghan will not be using the Queen's highly regarded doctors, insisting she doesn't want the men in suits to oversee the birth of her first child. Reported in the Mail on Sunday, in a significant break with royal tradition, Meghan has appointed her own delivery team, led by an unnamed female doctor. Royal Household gynecologists Alan Farthing and Guy Thorpe Beeston, who is a specialist in high-risk births, attended at the arrival of all three of the Duke and Duchess of Cambridge's children. They are among the best in the world, but neither has been given the leading role in Meghan's care. And she has politely declined their services as lead physicians for the birth. In keeping with protocol, the Queen's doctors cannot be excluded completely. There will be some role for them, and should something go wrong, as it did with the Countess of Wessex, the Queen's doctors would step in and take over. One source said, Meghan said she doesn't want the men in suits. She was adamant that she wanted her own people. It did leave a few of us a little baffled. Another said, it is slightly surprising. These people, the Queen's doctors, are the best of the best, and when it comes down to it, their role would actually be very limited in the birth itself, assuming all goes to plan. It is understood that meetings to discuss the birth will be held as the due date approaches, with the baby expected next month. Other royals to have given birth under the care of royal gynecologists include Princess Diana and Princess Anne. Sources close to the Duchess stressed the personal nature of her decision, with one insider saying, "Above all, this is her birth, her baby, and she must do whatever feels right for her. How could anyone judge her for that?" There is concern, however, that Meghan's choice will be viewed by some as unnecessarily extravagant. The Queen's physicians do not charge a fee, yet taking on a new team of specialists will cost tens of thousands. A source explained, "Working for the royal household is seen as an honor and attracts other high-profile fee-paying patients." Sources close to the Duchess insisted last night that her preference has not caused any offense. One said, "No one has thought anything of it because it really is ever so personal." In another break with tradition, it emerged last week that the Duchess has chosen not to give birth in the Lindo wing at St. Mary's Hospital, Paddington, which has been used by several other royal mothers. It is likely Meghan and Harry will choose a hospital nearer to their new home, Frogmore Cottage at Windsor, for the birth. As the baby will not be a direct heir to the throne, the couple are said to believe they should not have to pose for the world's media with the new arrival. There is expected to be a brief announcement shortly after the birth with a picture released later. It's understood that Meghan does not want the pressure of dressing up and posing just because people think she should. The source added, "It is impossible to compare to the Duchess of Cambridge because she is married to the future king. While the focus is very much on Harry and Meghan at the moment, this is not going to last, particularly as the Cambridge children grow up and become the core royal family. Meghan follows a number of other royals to give birth at a later age. The Queen was the same age when she gave birth to Prince Edward, the Countess of Wessex was 38 when she had her daughter, Lady Louise, and 42 when she had James, Viscount Severn, while the Duchess of Cambridge was 36 when Prince Louis was born last year. Queen Victoria had her youngest child when she was 37. The royal gynecologists labelled the men in suits by the Duchess of Sussex are among the most eminent in the world. One of them, Sir Marcus Setchell, served the Queen for 2 decades and postponed his retirement to deliver the Duke and Duchess of Cambridge's first child, George, in 2013. "He called it the pinnacle of my career." Adored by patients for his empathetic approach, Sir Marcus, 75, has brought thousands of babies into the world. He also helped to save the life of the Countess of Wessex, who collapsed when Lady Louise was born prematurely in 2003, after the placenta ruptured the womb lining. Sir Marcus says, "There is nothing quite like that first cry at the moment of birth, and no matter how many babies one has delivered, it remains a privilege, even if it's at 3 o'clock in the morning, to share that moment of joy, relief and excitement." On his retirement in 2013, he was made a Knight Commander of the Royal Victorian Order, a personal gift of the Queen. Before he took over from Sir Marcus as the Queen's surgeon gynecologist, Alan Farthing was better known as the fiancé of murdered TV presenter Jill Dando. The 55-year-old helped deliver all 3 of the Duchess of Cambridge's children. Quietly spoken and fastidiously polite, he is said to have the perfect bedside manner, always cautious, always in control and very charming. When Miss Dando was killed in 1999, Mr. Farthing overcame his grief by ignoring friends' advice to take 3 months off and instead plunged himself into his work, often operating late into the evening. He now has a private and NHS practice in London's leading hospitals, as well as rooms in Harley Street,